What's going on, YouTube? What's going on? Coming back at you with a much needed video that I've been thinking about doing for quite some time, and I think now's the time to do it. We're starting a new year, 2017, so I think the information that I want to go over in this video is going to be very helpful for, I'd say, a lot of people in the world, especially in America. For the most part, as you see, the title is going to be titled "How to Survive the Encounter with Police and Law Enforcement Officials." And I think this is very much needed because, as we have noticed over the past, I would say at least 5-6 years, there've been a lot of officer-involved shootings with the public. A lot of citizens killed, be it for whatever reasons, people being innocent and wrongfully shot and killed or assaulted, beat up, or those who were indeed, I guess you would say, guilty of a crime that was also shot, killed, or assaulted. The things I'm going to go over today is not to, I guess you would say, throw shade or to look down at law enforcement officials, because myself, I am a retired law enforcement official. Well, I worked as a deputy sheriff for many years. And nor is it a way of demonizing the public or citizens or civilians. But what this information is going to be going over is do's and don'ts, and really the most important thing on how to survive the encounter with law enforcement officials. And also how law enforcement can actually better themselves when dealing with the public also. So this is not going to be one-sided. This is going to be going over the do's and don'ts for both sides of the spectrum. And we're just going to jump on in it. Now, by no means is this is going to be going over how to get out of a speeding ticket and things of this nature or blah, blah, blah. This is mainly for your, basically your life, your physical wear and being, and making sure that you're able to go home at the end of the day, you know, be it if you're a civilian or a law enforcement official, because at the end of the day, we all want to go home to our families and loved ones. So we're going to jump right on in it. Like I said, I'm a retired law enforcement official, former deputy sheriff, where I worked for right at 10 years. And I retired and decided to go in another direction. But there's a lot of things that I saw as a law enforcement official while I was there and things that I still see now. That law enforcement, I think, in my opinion, go at things in a wrong way, and also how civilians go at things really in the wrong way. And I think a lot of that is due to the media, mainstream media, social media, whatever, just media in general. So I'm gonna jump into a quick story real fast to get this going. Where I was a deputy sheriff at, everyone was required to work inside the county jail, which I think is a very, very, very good thing. And I'm going to explain why I think it's a very good thing with this story. But everyone is mandatory, has to start out in the county jail, where we house federal, county, state, and city criminals or people waiting to go to trial or what have you. So we had some of your, say, your petty crime people all the way to your very serious crime people. And, you know, we had some very bad people there, and we had some people that was, you know, just made one or two mistakes and they had to come to jail for, could have been a day to however long. And some people actually came in and was out within a few hours. So we dealt with a very wide spectrum of people or criminals or people that have committed crimes or offenses. But everyone has to start off in the jail. And they see the story. I had already been in the jail right at 3 years. And where I worked, everybody worked in the jail, and then they rolled out. And rolled out means go out and patrol and do, you know, patrolling, policing, such as that. So I had already been there 3 years, knew I was about to get ready to roll out pretty soon. So at that point in time, you know, all of us that's on the list to roll out, we kind of just sit back, chill, let the newer guys, you know, learn how to do the job. And one day we had a guy come in, I want to say a state cop, state trooper brought him in, and the guy was combative when he brought him in. He's bringing him into the county jail, and once the state trooper signed his paperwork, he's gone. So now we have to deal with him. So this guy was still combative, upset, mad, because he came to jail. Obviously been arrested and maybe having to be in jail for a few months, maybe a little longer than that, depending on what his crime was. I knew it was not something that you're just going to be in and out for, because obviously it was a lot madder than somebody that knew they were just going to come in and get out. But he came to jail, was combative, and we let, you know, some of the what we call rookies, newbies or whatever, you know, take care of the situation, you know. But we always was in the close proximity to him, making sure everything's good. So, and this is not to throw any shade at anybody, but one of the officers that was what we call dressing out the guy, when they come in, we got to take their clothes and give them what we call county jumpsuits, or, you know, what people see on TV is your stripe jumpsuits or whatever. But doing that interaction with the deputy, and now what would be considered an inmate, the inmate was still aggressive, still agitated and upset and combative. So on any given day, normally it's just one deputy changing out one inmate. It's just how it normally is. Sometimes if the inmate is extremely aggressive or coming in on extremely high volatile charges, it would be two, maybe three changing them out. But when this took place, it's just him and the deputy, and we were still, you know, watching pretty good. But long story short, the inmate decided to basically jump at the deputy in an aggressive manner. And when that took place, this deputy froze. He didn't throw up his hands to try to protect himself. He didn't try to jump back, get in the distance. He just literally froze. And I think it really threw even the inmate off, because he kind of hesitated. And once he realized all the deputy froze, that's when the inmate then attempted to try to lay hands on him. But like I said, we were real close to the two, and as soon as we saw the inmate actually try to make an overact to attack the deputy, then we all took care of business and prevented any injuries and things to take place. So after everything was done, we dressed the inmate out, put him in a cell and whatnot, and I took it upon myself to pull this deputy off to the side, and I talked to him, and I was like, what happened? You know, I wanted to see what was going on through his head. Because at that time, I was on the what's called ERT team, emergency response team, where I was doing anywhere from firearms instructing, self-defense instructing, and other things. So I pulled him up to the side, and I talked to him, and I asked him what was going on through his head, just to see where he was. And he was truthful to me. And he told me, he said he was scared. And I was like, okay, you know, I can understand that. And I was like, well, tell me what type of level of fear were you experiencing? And he said he really couldn't think, but he knew he was afraid, and he thought that the guy was really going to hurt him and everything else. And I was like, well, I was like, have you ever been in a fight? That's first thing that came to my head was, well, let me ask you, because, if he's been in a fight before, it shouldn't be, that bad, because no one in the jail, when you're in the jail, no one's got firearms, things of that nature, or weapons. So it would have just literally been just a fist fight, So I asked him, I was like, have you ever been in a fight? And he was truthful to me, and he said no. And I've never, and this guy was probably 25 at the time, and I was kind of taken back. I was at a miss because I've never heard at this particular time, I've never heard a grown man in his 20s say he's never been in a fight. And this guy said he'd never been in a fight. And I said, what do you mean? I was like, have you, high school, middle school, brothers, you and your brother fighting or tussling or whatever. I'm like, you've never been in a fight. And he said, no, I've never been in a fight. I was like, so let me get this understood. I said, you've never been punched. You've never been, kicked. You've never been aggressively handled. And he's like, no, I've never been in a fight. Never been hit, never been punched. And, I was just afraid that if he hit me, I wouldn't have knew what to do. So I tell the story because not only had I heard him say that, after he told me he'd never been in a fight, I had, before I rolled down patrol and actually came back in jail to drop inmates off and just talk to the new guys, introduce myself, I had probably, I would say, easily 7 to almost 10 grown men tell me they'd never been in a fight before. So my suggestion was obviously, get in a gym where you can take boxing, MMA, karate, something. I say, because you need to know what it means to get punched in the face or whatever and how to move forward. Because in law enforcement, you got to be able to move forward. You cannot freeze. So long story short, instructed him to do that, boxing, MMA, some form of combative art so that you can get accustomed to aggressive behavior. And the same things I said to the other people after this first time. But the reason I'm telling you this, people that's watching this, is when these officers out here on the streets and you have something like a shooting and someone's killed or somebody's really beat up or whatever, and they do a report and it turns out the officer said he feared for his life and all this, listen to me. That is true. There's a lot of officers out there that get into situations where shots are fired or a civilian has been aggressive, and even to the point where a civilian has punched or hit an officer, that officer very well might be fearful of his life. And because of that, he goes to the weapon that he feels more comfortable with to protect his life, which is his gun, and he shoots and kills somebody. Now, that's a bad thing, in my opinion. That's very bad. And that's why I say it's good for everybody to start off in the jail. What the state I'm in, as far as I know, our county was the only county that required everybody to start off in jail, which is good because of these type of situations. If you've never been in a fight, never been hit, it's 100% chance in that jail, every deputy is going to get in a fight. And they're going to have to deal with, like I said, from the low criminals to the high level criminals, anywhere from petty theft to murders. That's just crazy. So it actually trains the officers how to deal with all walks of life in a more controlled environment where, the loss of life is just really, really slim to none to take place, versus taking a brand new deputy or a brand new officer that's never been in a real life fight, never been a real life threat, and putting them out on the street, giving them a gun and weapons that can kill somebody, and putting him in a situation where he might come across a guy that's completely unarmed, that's got a little size on him, that says, I don't want to go to jail, and hits the officer. And that officer then goes to a mental state of fear. I've never been in a fight. I've never been in this type of altercation. Oh, I fear for my life. Let me shoot and kill this person. That's bad. And I think that goes back to, number one, training within the academies. And I'm going to talk on academies, too. And really, psychological exams, which I'm going to talk on that here in a second. And putting these officers in positions that they're not ready to be in just yet. But when you hear grown men that's police officers, deputies, state troopers, state police, whatever, tell you they've never been in a fight and they just now becoming a police officer, law enforcement official in their 20s, and you go put them right out on the street and put them in a situation where they do have the right to literally take a life, and everything's going to be on their side unless it's proven without a shadow of a doubt that they were negligent in their actions. That is bad. And that's why we got all these unnecessary deaths going on with the citizens out there. Because you have people that don't want to go to jail, rightfully so. I mean, I can understand why a person don't want to go to jail. And they try to fight for their freedom, even though they may have committed a crime, but that doesn't mean you kill an unarmed person. And that's what we've been seeing a lot here lately. So one thing, academies, I'm going to jump on that real quick. In the state of Alabama and other states, not just Alabama, their law enforcement offices that only requires literally 3 months of an academy. 3 months. Now, there's places in Alabama that has 6 month long academies, which I think at bare minimum is okay. 6 months. 3 months, I personally think, is a joke. I think it's wrong for the citizens and the public that's supposed to be protected by the police. I think it's bad for them because you're now taking somebody that's never done anything to go through only 3 months of an academy that you put out on the street with a gun and a badge that have the authority and the right to take your freedoms and your life with only 3 months of experience or 3 months of training. And when I say training, you literally might only have 1 week of firearm training. And when I say 1 week, I mean 5 days because no one's at the academy on Saturday and Sunday. So you're talking about 5 days. And you're talking about, for example, one or two of those days is only going to be classroom work. So you really only got 3 days of on-the-range shooting at steel targets, not moving targets, steel targets, stationary targets. So that's bad. That's really bad. And, you know, the rest of the training could be, you know, something on, you know, the laws, something on search and seizures, things of that nature. But overall, 3 months is not enough time, in my opinion, to properly train anyone to be a law enforcement official. And when I went through the academy, I went through one of the academies. Honestly, that was 3 months. It was a little bit over 3 months. Actually, it was, let's see, it was 4, 8. So, yeah, it was 3 months. Yeah, it was actually 3 months. And that was it. And I thought it was a joke. Because coming from the type of background I had going into the academy, I was expecting something significantly different. And I grew bored with it. I learned everything I needed to learn, but my biggest training came after the academy when I started putting my own money into myself and my own training, going to federal schools, going to military-based police schools that I put myself through, which a lot of police officers do, and the majority don't. Like I said, there was academies that's the maximum, the biggest academy we have in the state is 6 months, and that's the state academy and one of our larger, bigger cities in the state. And I was, you know, I think that's okay, but honestly, I don't think 6 months is long enough, to tell you the truth. I know big states like Texas, Florida, New York, California, places like that have 1 year long academies. One of my best friends, he's a police officer in Dallas, in Texas, and their academy is a 4 year. And I think that's, I think it's a 4 year, it's just right at a year. That's great. I think that's what should be minimal. If you're going to put somebody in the public with these abilities to take a freedom and take a life. But across the board, that's the majority. Most of your police academies are 3 months to 6 months maximum. That needs to change. And you can do the research yourself. I mean, that's pretty easy to find. I mean, on average, you're going to get 6 months as the maximum outside of the big states, like I said, like, you know, cities like New York, Miami, Texas, California, L.A., places like that. So that's one of the biggest problems. These officers are not trained, in my opinion, properly to handle certain situations, especially when you're taking people 21, because all that's required to be a police officer in the United States of America is be 21 years of age. You're talking about people that may just have a GED or just have a high school diploma or just graduated college coming into law enforcement, never been in a real life situation, and they don't have the mental capacity to do what's needed to carry out their actions because they haven't had the proper training. And a lot of them haven't had the proper psychological evaluations. One of the police departments that I were going through here before I got hired on with the sheriff's office, the psychological exam for that thing was like a joke. It literally could have been me sitting down coloring out a coloring book, to tell you the truth. It was all 100% multiple choice, dislike, like, and looking at some geometrical shapes. And, you know, I was like, this got to be a joke. I mean, what, you know, I don't know. I don't design these tests, but what can you tell about my mental capacity and my psychological outlook on life and death and things of that nature through a multiple choice, agree, disagree, geometrical shape type test? It's ridiculous. And I hope, I mean, it's been a while since I took that test, and I hope they have revised that test. But when I started going through the hiring process with sheriff's office, I can't say they did sit down. We had written essay questions that we had to fill out. We had, I think it was like a 600-question questionnaire we had to do, and they set us in a very small room. I mean, they really play with your mental capacity. And after taking that, and everything was on a time limit, after that, we then had to sit down with the actual psychologist for an hour, and he questioned us and talked to us and had dialogue. So I think that was good. And I'm pretty sure a lot of departments outside of the state does something very similar to that. And I think that's very good. But it really comes down to training. These academies are not long enough, and I personally don't think that they go over necessary protocols, necessary situations to really properly train a lot of these police officers, especially hand-to-hand combat and even firearms training. It's a lot of things that can be done and taught to keep people from getting injured and hurt. So that's my take on law enforcement sides. It's just the training. The training is not up to par. It's just not up to par. There's a lot more that needs to be done and should be done. On the civilian side, people, listen to me. 1 mile per hour over the posted speed limit is against the law. So if you get pulled over by a police officer for breaking the law, and you know you were breaking the law, don't be, excuse my language, an asshole and get mad because a police officer is doing his job. His job is to pull over, stop people, apprehend people that's breaking laws. If you break a law, man up or woman up, however you want to say it, to what you did. You broke the law, receive that ticket. Don't be an asshole to the police officer. If he asks for your license registration, proof of insurance, give it to him, get your ticket, go home. If you're breaking the law and you know that you should not be doing this or that, and the police come to take you to jail, go to jail. It is better for you to go to jail than go to the grave. A lot of these situations taking place are taking place because people are just being assholes, getting mad because they got caught for doing something wrong and the police officers having to do their job. So my advice to the civilians out there, use common sense. Stop letting your emotions get you in situations that you don't need to be in. If you broke the law, and 9 times out of 10, you knew you broke the law, keep calm, give them what they asked for, or go and put them handcuffs on, go to jail, bail out, go home. That's all I got for y'all today. Survive the encounter. Don't be crazy and dumb, because there are some very scary police officers out there that has not been trained properly that will kill you. So keep calm, relax, listen, obey the rules, and everything will be all right. I'll be back with y'all with another video soon. Thank you. Bye.